You're awesome. Amen. On Friday night, we had an amazing campus devotional. We had a preach-off. It was based off of 1 Peter 3:15. It said, always be prepared to give a reason for the hope you have in Jesus. And I said, guys, we got to know why we believe what we believe. I made a cube, six sides, and it had six biblical topics on there. People would come up at random, we'd throw the cube, and whatever it landed on, they had to open up the Bible and preach from it for 90 seconds. The room was hot. It was going amazing at the preach-off. Not just the campus, we all need to know why we believe what we believe. I'm sure a lot of us know why we make disciples. Matthew 28, Mark 1, several other passages on why we make disciples. And in a moment here, we're going to have the special mission sisters come up. And they're going to encourage us with the special missions thermometer. And that's what we're going to talk about here this morning, is special missions contribution. So let's invite the sisters to come on up. And after we do this, then we'll continue the rest of the lesson as we move forward. As you know, we got a thermometer here, heating things up. Our goal is $129,000 by faith to get that by May 29th. And last week we were at $34,000. As of today what we have collected today was $5,806, which puts us at a new grand total of $41,427. So it's heating up a little bit. Looks great. Good job, guys. Thank you. Like I said, we're going to talk about special missions, but like I was saying, you know, we know why we make disciples, why we share our faith. I think we know why we take communion. Jesus says, remember me. I think we know why we confess our sins. The Bible says, walk in the light, confess, and pray for each other. I think we know why we come to church. Jesus says, seek the kingdom. But I want to make sure this morning we know why we give special missions. Because it's really hard to get behind something you don't know why you're doing it. And you don't know what it's for. Asking questions like, do I really know why we do this? Is it even in the Bible? Do I need to give special missions? Should I give special missions? Does God want me to give special missions? Why do we call it missions? Why do we call it special missions? Why is giving money special? What's so special about special missions? That's the title of our lesson tonight, this morning, is what's so special about special missions? Look under your chair. I put together for us a Bible study on special missions contribution. It is a legal size paper, 8.5 by 14 inches, two sides. A Bible study on why we do special missions. And my goal here is we walk out of here with a biblical conviction on giving special missions. Today's the first month of May. Excuse me, first day of May. It's the month of May, first day of May. And with special missions being May 29th, I went ahead and I nicknamed the month of May for us, Missions May. Missions May. Here going forward, we are totally laser focused on special missions. The Bible says we got to preach God's word, right? It also says you must teach God's word. I do a lot of preaching and some teaching too, but today is a good amount of teaching today. I'm going to be edifying and teaching us with the Word of God on what special missions is this morning. You have a study there that basically mimics my notes for the sermon today. I'm going to be going through that with you. I do have more things in my notes. I didn't give you everything on there. But you have the skeleton of what we're going to look at today, and that's for you to keep and get your convictions from. And don't read ahead. You're going to get lost and you're not going to listen. Follow with me as we go through this. So the first thing is why are we doing special missions? We might be thinking, didn't we just do that in February? And didn't we just do that in November? And didn't we just do that last spring? You are absolutely right. But here's why we're doing special missions. The world is still lost. There are still lost souls. The gospel needs to go everywhere. And just as Jesus wants everyone to be saved, we must want everyone to be saved. It is a command of God. But this is also why we're doing special missions. Because we were asked to. I want to camp on this one for a second. This is why we're collecting $130,000. We were asked to. Let me explain. In our church, we have convictions from the Bible, like I was sharing. And we believe in church building and from the scriptures in the first century church, we have some convictions from the Bible that we believe are totally biblical when it comes to building churches. Number one, we believe that all scripture is from God. Old Testament, New Testament, it is all the Word of God. We also believe God's church is made up of only baptized disciples for the remission of their sins. We also believe in speaking where the Bible's silent and being silent where the Bible speaks. Meaning, the Bible says do something, you do it. If it doesn't say anything explicitly like, hey, make sure you meet on Sundays at 10 a.m., then you can do that as long as it doesn't break any other command. We also believe that Jesus' command is to evangelize the world in our generation, to make disciples of all nations. That's an awesome thing to believe, but it doesn't work if everyone tries to do it on their own and in their own way. It doesn't work. Which leads to our other conviction, number five. We believe in a central leader with a central leadership. We believe in leadership. When you look through the Bible with Moses, Joshua, David, Jesus, the apostles, whenever there was a strong central leader, God's people were unified and they did his will. We believe the exact same thing. We don't believe in autonomy and self-governing churches. We work together as a team. The first century was a movement of churches. Therefore, the 21st century is a movement of churches. So, if we believe in leaders making decisions to unify us, when our leaders ask us to be responsible for doing our part in special missions, we do so. Why? Because that takes a lot of faith in God, takes trust in God, and submission to God and his leaders. Submission. I want to talk about submission. Submission only happens when you have to get behind something that you yourself probably wouldn't have naturally decided for yourself. This happens all the time in marriage. My wife loves almond milk ice cream. Delicious. She can't have milk, so we eat almond milk. When I say, hey, honey, when we go to the grocery store, let's buy ice cream. She does not have to submit. She's fired up. She's like, you're the best husband ever. The most amazing leader in the world. That is probably the smartest thing you've ever said. I'm fired up. No submission is needed because my wife would buy it on her own. She's fired up about almond ice cream. Now, if I said, hey, honey, this time, we're not going to buy ice cream. I don't think it's best. I think looking at, you know, let's just hold off on the $6 little thing of ice cream. Let's hold off. Now, because my wife loves almond ice cream, and this one time I say, let's not do that this time, that's when submission comes into play. Yeah. Is it sinful to not buy almond ice cream? No. Is almond ice cream sin? No. Is it sinful to buy almond ice cream? No, not at all. It's simply a judgment call, right? Much like when you choose what kind of ice cream you want to buy. It's your judgment. It's up to you, right? But my wife, in her humility and spirituality, has decided to submit herself to me. And when I make a decision that she might not naturally want to do herself, that's when she has to choose, okay, am I going to trust God in this decision and trust my leader, my husband? That's when you got to submit. Same thing applies to in our church. You don't have to submit to what you already want to do. Hey guys, we're going to have a talent show. That sounds awesome. No submission needed. You're just like, that's like an amazing idea, Richie. I wish you'd do that all the time. So if you love talent shows, there's no submission needed. Same thing if, you know, I say, hey, let's take communion today. You love that idea, no submission needing. But when we do need to submit to our leaders is when it's something that we maybe didn't even decide on our own, come up with, even agree with, or would naturally do on our own. But that's okay, because in Hebrews 13, the Bible says, submit to your leaders. Because they keep watch over you, make their joy, their work a joy, not a burden. Biblical submission is a beautiful thing. There's nothing wrong or sinful about it. This is not what our critics say, being silenced. That's not what that is. For us who are from our former fellowship, I need you guys to hear me on this. True biblical submission on godly principles, and if we don't agree with it, that's okay. You can discuss those things. But at the end of the day, if it's not an unbiblical command or thing we're doing, we got to get behind it. And being asked, hey, I need you to get on board with this, is not being silenced. It's not being hushed up. No, it's asking, hey, here's the mission. I need you to get on board. Yeah. If it's an opinion matter. Come on, bro. Look at your flow chart. Let me describe this flow chart for a second. This is how submission works with God and his church and leadership. Before we read the flow chart, I want you to listen to this. Before you read the flow chart, listen to this. Someone describes church submission in this way, and I really like it. He says, specifically, if someone were to say that if the Bible's silent about a particular matter, then so should all the ICC leaders be. And the decision of the individual should then prevail, if that's a thought. Then they might also accuse a leader in our church of preempting individuals' freedom to speak where the Bible's silent whenever leaders within our fellowship make a binding decision. So it's saying that, you know, this is not a good idea, you know, hey, if the Bible's silent, it doesn't mean you can make a decision and then we have to obey. That's what this idea is saying, right? But the fact is, from the Bible does speak on this matter. It says, obey and have confidence in your leaders and submit to them, Hebrews 13. So it does give a command. That is an example of the Bible speaking. And so before a non-leader exercises his individual decision, it must first be checked against what the Bible commands. Right? That's walking like Jesus. If the Bible has no specific command about a matter, and a church leader hasn't issued a biblically consistent directive either, then the final decision falls to the individual, who must nevertheless then account for their making of that decision. It is simplified into your flowchart. Number one, the Bible speaks, arrow, I obey, end. That's it. Hope we agree on that. Number two, the Bible's silent. Okay, hold on. Bible's silent on something. But a church leader speaks, and the Bible doesn't countermand the leader's decision, then what do? I obey. End. The Bible's silent. Church leader is silent on this issue. I decide I'm accountable to God at the very end. It's very simple. It's very simple. For us, the reason we're doing special missions is one, the world is lost. But the other reason is, guys, quite frankly, we're asked to by those who lead us. And if giving special missions is not unbiblical, then what do? We obey our leaders. We do. Because the Bible says obey your leaders. So the Bible does speak on the topic of obedience to leaders. As long as the leader's not calling you to do something sinful or against your conscience that God gave you, then it's totally authoritative from God himself. So is special missions an opinion matter? It can be, but it's also a biblical matter, which is what we're going to look at right now. So what is special missions? Ultimately, it's money given to support missions work around the world and the United States, given to plant new churches and continue support for churches that can't support themselves. Full-time leadership into people instead of buying buildings. That's a great deal of special missions. I have 7 quick things I want to help us get and I want to teach on why we do special missions, and it really is in the Bible. I got to convince you, special missions, we just call it that. It's in the Bible. I promise you. Number one, people and money, that's special missions. In the Old Testament, Israel, they needed to build God's temple. What did they need? They needed a lot of money and a lot of people. You put those together, you get the temple. That's why you see in the book of Nehemiah, when he goes back from Persia over to Jerusalem, Cyrus then gives him people and he gives him money to go build the temple. Check out Solomon's temple. Let's look at how much money it cost to build Solomon's temple. Not counting bronze, which is expensive metal, and using the average current price of gold, the gold alone of Solomon's temple would have been an astonishing $194,404,500,000. No, that's just the gold. The silver would have been $22,199,076,000. Added together, the gold and silver used in Solomon's temple was worth $216,603,576,000. This does not include all the precious metals, like diamonds and things like that. Bronze, iron, ivory, or cedar wood used in the temple. Then he goes on and says, extrapolating, you know, the cost of Solomon's temple would include the labor costs. It says about 153,000 forced laborers, so paying them technically, would have been well over $500 million. A cost simply unimaginable in today's world for one building. Building the temple took over 7 years. And then check this last part out. He needed wood. A great quantity of cedar trees were used, so many, in fact, that Solomon had to pay King Hiram with 20 towns in Galilee. Hey, King Hiram, we're going to build this cranking temple. I need some wood. He goes, okay, well, give me 20 of your cities in Galilee. Okay. Just give me the wood. 20 towns. Gone. There you go. Yours. We're going to build a temple. Now, whose idea was it to build a temple? Solomon's. It was David and then Solomon. Who's he? Well, he was the leader of God's people. He said, hey, we're going to build a temple. And then what do you do? Hey, we only need about $216 billion. That's it, guys. Like, it's just $216 billion. It's not that much. But we're going to build a cranking temple for God. The same things needed in the 21st century. We are God's temple, his church. It needs money. It needs people. It's the exact same thing. I just threw on there some things that the money pays for when it goes to special missions. Visas. You go to a foreign country, you need a visa. That's a lot of money. You need a plane ticket to another foreign country. That's a lot of money. Now try taking 15 people on a plane to that foreign country. That's a lot of money. You need facility rental cars when they get there. Well, they got to have somewhere to meet. The church costs, just things that go of functioning of a church, microphones, anything like that. Church legal costs, getting things set up with the government so they don't get kicked out of the country. That costs money. Church insurance to make sure that no one can go and just sue the church for something that they trip and stub their toe. Housing costs, that means setting up the missionaries when they arrive on a foreign country they've never been and they're brand new and they just get there. We do the generosity of making sure they have somewhere to live. Come on, bro. Hey, we'll set you up in an apartment, first month's rent, and then you got to figure it out. That costs money. And then the couple who's leading that mission team, we give them money so they don't have to get a job, but they can actually plant the church. So we'll give them their salary for a year or two maybe to make sure they can preach the word and devote themselves to that. Those are just some of the costs. I'm not an administrator, but I just know those are some of the costs.
Come on, bro.
Building God's temple simply costs money. It does. That's one thing special missions is. Number two. Special missions is about repenting from greed, the love of money. Go to 1 Timothy chapter 6. Look in verse 6. But godliness with contentment is great gain. For we brought nothing into the world, and we can take nothing out of it. But if we have food and clothing, we'll be content with that. Will you really? People who want to get rich, they fall into temptation and a trap and into many foolish and harmful desires that plunge men into ruin and destruction. For the love of money is a root of all kinds of evil. Some people eager for money have wandered from the faith and pierced themselves with many griefs. Special mission should and always prick your heart because it always helps to make sure, hey, You don't love money, do you? And that's when we get convicted. Because over the course of a year, when the last special mission, sometimes a little bit of greed creeps in there. And we start liking money a lot. Special missions is good. It helps us remember that, hey, if I just have something to eat and I have some clothes, I'm totally content biblically. And Matthew 6 says, seek the kingdom. God says, he'll give you food and clothing. He doesn't say he'll pay your bills. Doesn't say he'll give you a car. He says, I'll give you food and I'll make sure you stay warm. That's what God promises. And really, that's what we should be content with. Drop down to verse 17. Verse 17. Command those who are rich in this present world not to be arrogant nor to put their hope in wealth, which is so uncertain, but to put their hope in God who richly provides us with everything for our enjoyment. Command them to do good, to be rich in good deeds, and to be generous and willing to share. And in this way, they'll lay up treasure for themselves as a firm foundation for the coming age, so that they may take hold of the life that is truly life. Paul tells Timothy, Timothy, if there's anyone who's wealthy, you need to command them to be generous. Not ask them, not persuade them, command them to be generous. So I do what Timothy does, so I'm asked to command you guys to be generous. But some of us might say, well, hold up, buddy, I'm not rich. Hold up, that doesn't apply to me, I'm not rich. Do you see my paychecks in my bank account? I want to persuade you otherwise. We're filthy rich.
Come on, bro.
Only a couple amens on that one. Guys, we are really rich. We are very blessed, and we are very taken care of in America. Let me help you get some perspective. If you make $20,000 a year, you're in the wealthiest 10% of the world. Some of us think, wow, I'm super impoverished. Oh my gosh, 20,000. If you make 20,000, you're the top 11% of 7 billion people. Let's take a little further. You make $35,000 a year, so a little bit more. You're the wealthiest 5% in the globe. $35,000 a year, 95% of people in the world wish they had your income. You make $65,000 a year. That's a good job. You make $65,000 a year. You're in the wealthiest 1.2% of the globe. You're literally in the top 1% if you make 65 a year. 99% of the world is way poorer than you. Half the world lives on $2.50 a day. 3 billion people live on $2.50 a day. That's your morning Starbucks. And they would say, I would give that coffee to feed my family today if I could.
Come on.
I got to make that $2.50 feed my entire family.
Come on now.
The water in your toilet right now, if you go home, the water in your toilet, it is cleaner than what 1 billion people have to drink. 1 billion people in the world would show up on your doorstep and say, please, can I go to your toilet? I'm really thirsty. It's cleaner than my water. And some of us won't even clean our toilets because we think it's so dirty. Guys, 1 billion people would drink your toilet water without hesitation. And you flush it and we urinate it and we use it to go to the bathroom. It's cleaner than people's drinking water. If you have a refrigerator back home, clothes on your back, and a roof over your head, and somewhere to sleep, you are richer than 75% of the world, just those things. If you could read your Bible this morning, or right now if you didn't have a quiet time, you are more fortunate than 3 billion people who can't even read. Back in the old days and hundreds of years, other centuries, only the wealthiest and the wealthiest and the royalty could read. It's still the same today. I mean, 3 billion people cannot read. Because a lot of us got free education.
Come on, bro.
Anne Frank, she says, no one has ever become poor by giving. It doesn't happen. And the poorest man is he whose only wealth is money. The Bible commands us to be generous. So I'd have to say, I think we're rich. I'm just going to go ahead. I'm going to make a judgment here. Let me know if I'm wrong. We're all rich. I'd say we're all at least in the top 10% of the world. Maybe you're not. Maybe you're not in the top 10%. But you could go down the street and get food for free. You could find somewhere to sleep if you wanted to tonight. For free. Your needs would be met. You'd have running water if you wanted. For free. We're rich. So what does the Bible tell us to do if we're rich? Be generous. Generous is different from person to person. It's different, but God does say you better be generous. Guys, I have no right to ask us to do a special missions. I have no right to do so. But I'm convinced you believe in the mission. And because we believe in Jesus' dream, we're willing to be generous to see many souls saved. Right. Number three. A common objection to special missions. So I'm helping us get a biblical conviction, okay? So in case anyone has this objection, okay, check this one out, right? I've heard this one. I don't just have $5,000, right? Hey, we're going to do it 20 times. It's 20 times your normal contribution. You know, it's your goal. It's going to be awesome. And someone goes, I don't have that. I don't have $5,000 sitting around to just give. How can you ask that of me? And there's, biblically, if you look at the Bible, the Jews, they already had animals and grains and oils and all these different things, so they would just give what they already had. That's a great point. I want to help us with this. You're right, they did give what they had. So they had a flock, they would take a goat, sacrifice it. Totally right. You do the exact same thing. Check this out. Say you normally give $100 a week, that's your pledge. So your 20 times goal would be an awesome $2,000. You know, hey, let's go after this by faith. Let's do 20 times what you normally give. Let's do this. If you made more than $2,000 this past year, then you're in the exact same situation as the Jews. You get me? The issue is you just already spent it. There we go. There's a connection. So to give $5,000, $4,000, it's not extra. You already made it. You just did your W-2s and your taxes. You know how much you made. You made a lot more than your special missions goal. You just happened to spend it. That's no one's fault. That's not the leader's fault. Right? Yep. Right? God gives you the money to spend how you choose. He only asks that when I do give it to you, give it to me first. Honor me first. So when we say, hey, let's do this, let's do it 20 times, and your goal is 3,000, 4,000, whatever it is, 800, whatever it may be, you already made that in the past 365 days. You already had it. You just used it. So it's not too much to ask to give that because we give to God first. We just happen to do it a little backwards because we spent it already. A lot of us who aren't up here for the contribution, the new members, we knew special missions was coming. If you didn't, well, now you know. But you knew, and you knew how much you were probably going to make this year, and you just spent it. You didn't put it aside. That's okay. That's why we do fundraisers. We sell brownies. That's why we save. We do different things like this. But I need us to understand, that objection, it holds no weight with me. If you made more this past year than your special missions goal, then you had it. God gave it to you, much like the Jews had flocks. They have them. They just gave them. All right, let's move on. Number four. Special missions is supposed to hurt. 2 Samuel 24, let's go there. The world will not be evangelized very comfortably. It can't happen. Special missions is supposed to be a little painful, a little hurtful in your heart because you're going to feel it because it's a significant amount being asked of you. You're supposed to feel it. It's a good thing. And a common objection I can hear is, well, I'm really tight. This really hurts me to give this much. I would say you're absolutely right. And the issue is, what? 2 Samuel 24, look at verse 18. On that day, Gad went to David and said to him, "Go up, build an altar to the Lord on the threshing floor of Araunah the Jebusite." So David went up as the Lord had commanded through God, and when Araunah looked and saw the king and his men coming toward him, he went out and bowed down before the king with his face to the ground. Araunah said, "Why has my lord the king come to his servants?" "To buy your threshing floor," David answered, "so I can build an altar to the Lord that the plague on the people might be stopped." Araunah said to David, "Let my lord the king take whatever pleases him and offer it up. Here are the oxen for the burnt offering. Here are the threshing sledges and the ox yokes for the wood. O king, Araunah gives all this to the king." Araunah also said to him, "May the Lord your God accept you." But the king replied to Araunah, "No, I insist on paying for it. I will not sacrifice to the Lord my God burnt offerings that cost me nothing." David goes to build an altar. A guy gives him everything free. And he goes, "No, I insist on buying it." He goes, "I want to feel it when I make this sacrifice. I will not just give to God something that I don't feel and it costs me nothing." I want us to have the heart of David here, guys.
Come on, bro.
If your special missions doesn't feel like it costs you anything, then be more generous. Then be more generous. If your special missions is really, really stretching your faith and you feel totally tapped, that's good.
Come on.
It's real good. Because you're doing something worthy and it's costing everything you've got. There's nothing wrong with that. To stretch yourself, to make yourself uncomfortable, and to give your heart to something. Let's move on. Number 5. Like I said, we're teaching and getting a biblical conviction here.
Come on.
On why we do special missions. I want you to understand it's not something we made up. Another objection that I gotta be careful here to make sure I don't get mean, but I'll apologize if I do. Another common objection is my contribution is just between me and God, period. Let me just put something out here. I don't know who taught you that, where that came from, or a Bible verse you read that is false doctrine. And I'll convince you of that through the scriptures. The idea that, oh, it's just me and God. You don't need to know what I do. You don't need to know how. I'll give what I give, and that's what I'm going to do. You are in sin. That is not what the Bible teaches. That is your selfish idea of giving, and that is not what the Bible teaches. Let's go to 1 Corinthians chapter 9. The opposite is actually very true. Your giving absolutely is between you and God, but not limited to. It is absolutely between God and his people, the church and the leaders of the church. Let me show you why. 1 Corinthians 9. Let's read in verse 7. "Who serves as a soldier at his own expense? Who plants a vineyard and does not eat of its grapes? Who tends a flock and does not drink of the milk? Do I say this merely from a human point of view? No. Doesn't the law say the same thing? For it's written in the law of Moses, 'Do not muzzle an ox while it's treading out the grain.' Is it about the oxen that God is concerned? Surely he says this for us, doesn't he? Yes, this is written for us because when the plowman plows and the thresher threshes, they ought to do so in the hope of sharing in the harvest." He goes, if we've sown spiritual seed among you, what is that? Well, parable of the sower, throwing out God's word. Preaching. If we've sown spiritual seed among you, is it too much if we reap a material harvest from you? If others have this right of support from you, shouldn't we have it all the more? Like, I mean, you give your taxes for your military personnel. You pay your taxes for your school teachers. You know, the government institutes taxes. Paul's saying, hey, if we're preaching and taking care of the needs of the church and we're doing all these things, shouldn't we have that same right? But he says, but we don't use this right. He goes, I could, but I'm not going to use that right. On the contrary, we put up with anything rather than hinder the gospel of Christ. He's more concerned with the gospel. Don't you know that those who work in the temple get their food from where? The temple. And those who serve at the altar share in what is offered on the altar. In the same way, the Lord has commanded that those who preach the gospel should receive their living from the gospel. The Bible says the Lord commands that those who devote full time to preaching should be compensated for full time preaching. says, guys, he's like, you remember the Jews. You remember back in temple worship when we used to do that. He goes, don't you know those who work in the temple, they eat at the temple, and those who work on the altar, they eat what is offered on the altar? What is he referring to? Well, he's referring to Leviticus chapter 7. Let's go there. Leviticus chapter 7. So again, if we have this idea and we stand very firm, like, hey, you know, my Gibbons between me and God, I don't really need to tell you anything. I hope you repent and you let these scriptures hit your heart. Because it's absolutely not just between you and God. Look at this. Leviticus 7, verse 28. The Lord said to Moses, say to the Israelites, anyone who brings a fellowship offering to who? The Lord. So who's this going to? The Lord, okay. It's to bring part of it as a sacrifice to the Lord. With his own hands, he's to bring the offering made to the Lord by fire. He's to bring the fat together with the breast and wave the breast before the Lord as an offering. So who is the offering go to? It goes to God. Totally true. Now the priest, that's a person, shall burn the fat on the altar, but the breast belongs to Aaron and his sons. So the breast of the animal, who does it belong to? The Levites, Aaron and his sons. Well, where'd the animal come from? The Israelite. But what does God say the breast belongs to? The breast meat. Dude, those are the Levites. That's the Levite's breast. It's his, but it belongs to him. Okay, let's read on. You are to give the right thigh to your fellowship offerings to the priest as a what? Contribution. They're getting the good cuts of meat. Levites, they get the breast. Priests, they get the thighs. Lord's taking care of the Levites. He says, you give it to these guys. The son of Aaron who offers the blood and the fat on the fellowship offering, meaning who is performing the service of the ministry, shall have the right thigh as his share. From the fellowship offering of the Israelites, I have taken the breast that is waved and the thigh that is presented and have given them to Aaron the priest and his sons as their regular share from the Israelites. You can't extrapolate from this that giving is only between the Israelite and God. It's not. Your giving is absolutely between God, but look what he says in that last verse. He goes, hey, you know, from the offerings of the Israelites, I've taken the breast and the right thigh, and I give them to Aaron and the priest. So you're right, you do give to God, but where does it go? To the people. The Levites, those who minister, those who lead the people. Guys, I got to help you change your thinking here. Your contribution, yeah, there's a reason we do envelopes. Yeah, ever wondered about that? There's a reason. There's a reason we ask you to write your name. Because your contribution, your giving, determines if the priest, Levites, and Aaron's sons actually eat that day.
Come on,
totally serious.
Yep. That's right.
Whether or not we're giving actually matters if he will eat dinner at the temple that night.
Yep.
If they don't give, what do the priests eat?
Nothing.
Nothing. That's why in Nehemiah you see them plowing the fields, working their herds, and Nehemiah goes, what are you doing? They go, well, the people stopped giving. I had to eat somehow. So if you ever thought your giving is just between you and God, you're mistaken. Your giving is between you and God, but God says, you giving to me is between me and the priest. God doesn't need your money. Like, when you put it in the plate, your cash doesn't float to heaven. I haven't seen that, but I mean, no one's money. I mean, Jasmine accounts for all of it. It's there. Nothing's flying to heaven. The only missing contribution are those who don't give. That's the only ones we go, what happened to that one? That was weird. That sister didn't give. That's interesting. Okay. So it doesn't go to heaven. Why? Because God doesn't need it. But he says, give to me. And where's the money go to? His church. The church needs the money. Why? The dream of Jesus. The world is lost. So that's why we give. God doesn't need your money. He didn't need the animals. You see on your study guide there, Psalm 50, God, in that verse, he goes, dude, I don't need the bull from your stall or your goats. I don't need them. Even if I were hungry, I wouldn't tell you. That's Psalm 50. Even if I were hungry, I wouldn't even tell you. He goes, do I eat the flesh of bulls or drink the blood of goats? No, I don't. He goes, sacrifice thank offerings to God. Fulfill your vows to the Most High. So God does say, give to me. And what I mean is, you better give to the church. I don't need your money, but they do. The Levites do, who are ministering full-time for you. They need the money. Guys, let's repent of this thinking. That I don't write my name on the envelope. They don't need to know. Yes, we do. Yes, we do. Because you're giving. That's like walking up to the Levite and the priest saying, I got my animal, but I don't want you to look at it. Well, I mean, is it a goat? I'm not going to tell you. You got a blanket over it? This is between me and God. Well, dude, God commands me to sacrifice it. Well, figure it out, dude. But this is my goat. Oh, man. Whoops. Oh, sorry. I messed up. Oh, no. You know I have a goat. Oh, no. And the priest looks and goes, whoa, that thing's missing a leg, dude. That's why you're hiding it. It doesn't have a leg. Oh, you're ashamed because you don't want to give your best. That makes sense now. How about you go back, say a little prayer in your tent, and bring me the best one you got. And we'll sacrifice that on the altar. Don't come back till you do. Maybe we can try that. I mean, that's why you don't write your name on the envelope. That's why you don't give. That's why you're convinced it's between you and God. Because you got a crippled animal. You don't have a conviction on giving your best. So you're ashamed of it. You hide it under a little tarp. You know, I'm not going to tell you what I got. But if you, man, imagine if you have the most cranking, like, strong lamb that you brought. You'd be like, Aaron, here's my lamb. I took care of this guy. God's going to be fired up about this guy. If that's your heart, you joyfully give contribution. Giving in this church is not between just you and God. It is between you and God. It's between the Levites too. And the Bible says, I command us to be generous. Therefore, we're generous. So those who are paid by the generosity, paid by the church, can eat dinner. Amen. And eat meals. Chicken breasts and thighs. As the Levites did. Amen? Let's move on. Number 6. Special missions supplies the needs of God's people. We don't have time to read through it. I love this passage. I might preach on it another time. We can actually have time to read it. But 2 Corinthians 8, 1 through 5, Paul is taking up a collection for the Jerusalem church. He's taking up a collection from the Gentile churches to give to Jerusalem. And he's taking up this collection to give to them because there are a lot of poor people in Jerusalem. There's a couple reasons why they're super poor in Jerusalem. Number one, after a lot of Jews converted to Jesus, a lot of them would have been ostracized economically, meaning they'd be fired from their jobs. Number two, there was constant food shortages in Jerusalem. There was a famine in 46 AD. Paul does the special missions. Number three, the Jews in Palestine, they were also subject to twofold taxation, the Roman Empire and then also the Jews in the community. Lastly, the reason Jerusalem was poor at this time was Jerusalem was the mother church of the first century movement. That's where it all started. This church was obligated to support a large number of ministers and teachers and provide hospitality to them who would frequently visit to be instructed in God's ways. They took care of the family of God. So because of that, that's a big burden that Jerusalem carried. Our mother church, if you will, mother giving birth, is Los Angeles. We call LA Jerusalem. Jerusalem carries the biggest burden and the most expenses when it comes to the movement of God. It takes care of so many ministers and their families. And when special missions, if it comes short one time, LA makes it up from their pockets. If a church falls short, they go, well, the missionary in Santiago, they still need to eat, so we'll send them our money. No one else is asked to do that. They feel the biggest burden, but that's okay. Special Missions helps carry that burden. And it says Paul took the money, he collected it from the Gentile churches, gave it to Jerusalem to the poor. Now, we might be thinking, well, hold on, then we should be doing Special Missions just for mercy, just for the poor. Well, planting churches are mercy branches, and we help the poor. So that does serve that need, but also, a lot of Special Missions, it goes to the foreign ministers that get $1 a day for preaching the word. The foreign ministers whose congregations in Africa and the congregations in the third world countries that we have churches, that their congregation can't support them full time, they're poor. So we send them money. So Special Missions is in the Bible, church. Paul collected it from the Gentiles, gave it to the Jerusalem Jewish Christian church because they were poor and they needed it. We do the same thing today. We support the poor missionaries who need the money to plant those churches in countries we don't want to necessarily go to. But they will. And we say, you know what? How about we just make sure you eat while you're there? That's where Special Missions goes to. And lastly, number 7, we'll close out here. The last thing about Special Missions is that it is an expression of gratitude. Amen. It's an expression of gratitude. Paul asked these Gentile churches there in 2 Corinthians to give because of their debt to the Jews. Let me help you understand what that looks like biblically. Go to Romans chapter 15. Romans 15. Paul talks about this Special Missions he's doing. And he tells the Gentile churches, hey guys, we got to take up a 20 times. Here's why. The Jewish Christians, the guys who were here first, they need it. They need it. And he says, really, you owe it to these guys. Look at Paul's perspective here in Romans 15, verse 25. He says, now, however, I'm on my way to Jerusalem in the service of the saints there. For Macedonia and Achaia, Gentile churches, they were pleased to make a contribution for the poor among the saints in Jerusalem. They were pleased to do it, and indeed, they owe it to them. For if the Gentiles have shared in the Jews' spiritual blessings, meaning salvation, why? Because the church started with the Jews. The kingdom started with the Jews. He's saying, if the Gentiles are getting a spiritual blessing, they have now have salvation in God's kingdom. They owe it to the Jews to share with them their material blessings. He's saying, the reason you give Special Missions is because those before you, you owe it to them. Those who were in the church before you and planted the church, you owe it to those guys. Because you reap a spiritual harvest, the Bible says you owe them a material harvest. You then go and you help supply their needs. We're in debt to them who come before us. Yeah. And it's really incredible over there in 2 Corinthians 9, you don't have to turn there. But at the end of that passage, it says, when you do this, when you give, it says many more people will praise God. A lot more people will be saved because of your giving. What I mean is this, guys. You guys know our sister Joelle here in the church, right?
Yep.
Joelle's from Abidjan.
Come on.
She was baptized here a couple months ago, a few months ago. She goes, hey, we have a church in Abidjan? We go, yeah. She goes, my friend lives in Abidjan. She then contacts the church leader who we pay with Special Missions.
Come on, bro.
Because Africans don't make the salaries you make. So she contacts the minister who would be able to be there and to take care of the needs of the church from last year's Special Missions. Contacts the church leader, says, hey, my friend is there. Can you reach out to her? They reach out to her. She starts studying the Bible, and just a few weeks ago, she's baptized into Christ in Abidjan, Africa. That doesn't happen without Special Missions. There's no movement without Special Missions. If you were here in 2013 in D.C., if you were here in 2013 and you gave anything to Special Missions, you helped plant the Santa Barbara Church.
Come on, bro.
All the way from here. the church Elizabeth and I planted in 2013. And you know what's really cool about that is you don't even have to wait until heaven to see the fruits of it. Because you gave in 2013, you get to meet Josh and Nikki.
Come on.
Let's make that real for a second. Josh and Nikki are here because the church could be sent to Santa Barbara and they were reached out to. And you get to talk to them. What you gave in 2013, they're in the Kids Kingdom room right now.
Come on.
They're in the Kids Kingdom room. Another guy converted in Santa Barbara, his name's Andre. He got baptized, it was amazing. He said, well, my family, I want them to be saved. So because he got converted, then he reaches out to our sister church in Los Angeles, and they start studying with his brother. His brother gets baptized. Then after that, his mom takes note. Then his mom studies the Bible, she gets baptized. Wow. Then after that, the younger brother starts realizing, what's going on? He studies the Bible, he gets baptized. And then the dad goes, well, I better jump on board. He studies the Bible, and the whole family gets baptized into Christ. From special missions in 2013 to one guy named Andre, his entire family saved. That's what special missions does. I want the ushers to hand out a sheet here, and we'll close out the sermon right now. They're going to hand something out to you. Like I said, we had an amazing time on Wednesday night with the new members orientation.
Amen.
It was awesome. And as they're passing that out, I want you to listen to this as they pass it out. We had an icebreaker opening question for the night. It was awesome. I asked a crazy question just to see what people's responses would be. I said, if money was not an object and you had all the money you could ever want, what would be one thing you would buy? The answers were astonishing. It was awesome. Jennifer goes, well, I would like to buy an island and just hang out there for a little bit. Evangelize that nation. Kevin Chin, I love Kevin Chin's answer. Kevin Chin goes, well, if I had all the money, I would buy, here we go, a custom-made 24-karat gold 1984 NIV Thompson Chain Reference Large Print Study Bible. That's what Kevin would buy. Jeannie McGee, she goes, I'd buy Jack a Porsche 911. All right. Hey, man, that's a good wife. Maris, she goes, I'd buy a personal chef that would just cook for me all the time. Amen. Darlene was there. It was awesome. She came, you know, she moved here from Syracuse. She goes, I'd buy a church building so we could just meet there for free. And I go, would it have a basketball court? She goes, absolutely. Church with a basketball court. James, he goes, yeah, I'd buy a private jet so we could all just fly together to the GLC in different conferences. I'm like, bro. Then Destiny, she goes, you know, I'd buy a giant bus with beds, refrigerators, bathrooms, and we'd all travel to the conferences we got to go to in one bus. Then Matthew, he goes, I would buy one giant piece of land so we could all just live there. For free. And then I love Tamara's answer. I love her answer. It was good. She goes, I'd buy a giant house that came with the Land Rover. She just threw that in there. Buy a giant house that we all could live in with a personal chef, but the security of the house would be you would not be allowed to leave the house until you had your quiet time that day. I'm like, whoa! Why do I share those things? Because so many of these young Christians, the first thing that comes to mind when they say they have all this money is they say, I want to take care of the needs of the people. All of their things they'd buy were communal things that we all could use. Why would a new Christian say that? Here's why. They are grateful to be saved.
Come on, bro.
When you're grateful to be saved, you want to pay back everything you can to God and His kingdom, that which saved you. They are grateful. You got to ask yourself, are you grateful? for your salvation. If you're struggling with your 20 times, it's because you're losing gratitude. I want to read you an email, and then I want to go over that piece of paper that you see right in front of you. This is an email from Kip McKean. He sent this to the United States church leaders, and it's an encouraging email about our 20 times special missions. I want to read this, and then I want to talk about that for a minute, and then we'll be done, and then Nikki's going to come up and get baptized today, which is going to be awesome. Amen. He says, "Greetings from New York City. What a tremendous weekend with the New York City Church. Elena and I were privileged to introduce Luke and Brandon Speckman to your New York City Church as their new church leaders on Friday night at the Congregational Devotional. This congregation has overcome so many satanic attacks through the courageous interim leadership of Jay and Barb Shelbreck. Of note, their weekly giving has increased from $6,200 a week when the Shelbrecks took over in early January to now over $9,000 a week. On Sunday, Brandon did a remarkable job sharing for communion. Luke blew it out on the sermon. Also, the singing was outstanding. And so, as of Sunday, the New York City Church has 152 disciples, and God gave us 233 in attendance. Please keep New York City in your prayers, and the Speckmans will arrive with a small supplemental mission team in late June." Then it reads on, Hebrews 10:24, "Let us consider how we may spur one another on toward loving good deeds." As we approach the conclusion of our spring missions collection, I wanted to encourage you to spur on your congregation by sharing some of the following highlights with the disciples at midweeks and Sunday services to help inspire them in their giving. May 6th will be the 9th anniversary of the City of Angels International Christian Church. This Friday, the real beginning of our Fellowship of Churches. The original mission team of 42 from Portland, Oregon has multiplied to almost 4,500 disciples and an average Sunday attendance of 6,064 churches in 34 nations on all 6 populated continents of the world. Lord willing, the Spirit will plant 7 churches this year: Bogota, Colombia, Seattle, Washington, Lagos, Nigeria, Tampa Bay, Florida, Dubai, United Arab Emirates, Kinshasa, Democratic Republic of Congo, and Bangalore, India. At the Bogota inaugural service this past week, God graciously gave us 140 in attendance. Since the 26 in the Remnant Group joined the 5 on the mission team from Mexico City in March, they've seen 8 additions, 3 baptisms, 4 restorations, and 1 place membership. We now have 4 churches in Central and South America: Bogota, Mexico City, Santiago, and Sao Paulo, Brazil. With the planting of Lagos, Nigeria, and Dubai this year, God will initiate our 10th and 11th Crown of Thorns churches. This leaves us with only Hong Kong remaining in phase 1 of the Crown of Thorns project. And Lord willing, it will be planted from Sydney next year. Andrew Smelly is in Lagos as I write this. He's gathering the remnant right now, securing housing for the Lagos mission team, making plans for the 2nd African Missions Conference on June 24th. And amazingly, there are almost 600 disciples in 6 nations in Africa awaiting the arrival of Andrew and Patrick and the Lagos mission team. Manila had its inaugural service on June 7th. They had daily additions this past week, and daily additions are again predicted for this next week. In less than 11 months, the Spirit has given the Metro Manila Church 146 additions, 114 baptisms, 23 restorations, 9 place memberships directly from our former fellowship. And this spring and summer, we'll see the execution of the reconstructing of the City of Angels Church in LA, with ministry leaders changing out the regions and going on different places. This will allow the City of Angels Church to send Luke and Brandon Speckman to New York City and take the responsibility of the church there and oversee the efforts in India. As well, this excellent plan will enable us to send Corey and G. Blackwell in June to Chicago to lead this great church from there and build our Middle East world sector. Lastly, as in the days of Nehemiah, we'll be able to soon look back and say, this work has been done with the help of our God. Please keep us in your prayers as we depart from Moscow tomorrow to participate in the first Eurasian Missions Conference. We are family to the end. Kip. Look at your Crown of Thorns project. On this side, the side that doesn't look as pretty. I spilled water on mine, sorry. That right there was the Crown of Thorns project we had in 2009. 7 years ago, that's what we had. We had 11 churches in 2 countries. That was it. Then you flip it over after 7 years of special missions contribution. In just 7 years, the movement has multiplied into 64 churches in 34 nations in the world. From just 42 disciples in 2007 to almost 4,500 disciples worldwide. Now this is the Crown of Thorns project and what God has done through our generosity. Church, I want to encourage us today that special missions, oh baby, it's very biblical. I think it's hard to walk away from here today saying, I don't know if special missions is really a good thing to do. Yeah. Or if it's in the Bible. If you feel that way, I'm just going to say, please refer to your study sheets. It's on there. Let the scriptures hit your heart. Guys, let us not let the dream of Jesus die. What's so special about special missions contribution? It's seeing the world evangelized. I love you guys. Thank you very much. Awesome. Come on.